The State and City Council to order. Would those of a like mind please join me in the flag salute?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
By now, everyone understands the meaning of that word indivisible, not able to be divided. And we would all do well to remember that on the eve of a historic election. I hope everyone's voted by now. Okay, here we go. Roll call, staff introduction. Staff is all here that needs to be. I guess our attorney isn't, but probably didn't need to be here tonight. Let's see. We've got two counselors gone tonight. Counselor Esselman and Counselor Gladwell are excused absent tonight, so I don't know if we have any additions to the agenda. Keith, anything?
No, we do not.
Counsel, anything? Declarations of ex parte contact, conflict of interest, bias. Okay. Presentation, comments from the public. And we've got one possibility. I'll just address this. Greg Ellison, if you'd like to wait until we get into that public hearing, there'll be time to say whatever you need to say. Well, okay, thank you. So the canine dog, Canis lupus familiaris. Lieutenant B?
Yes, sir.
Did you know that there, you know, I'm looking at an article on the origins of dogs tonight. You know there's 28 different wolf subspecies?
I did not know that.
I didn't either until tonight. I just thought I'd share that. I knew you'd deal with that well. Okay, go ahead.
Thanks, Mr. Mayor, member of the council. I get the pleasure of coming and introducing Dallas tonight. Dallas has been with our agency since April. And a little bit of a backstory. I know probably most of you have already heard this, but he was a drug dog with the University of Arizona. He sustained an injury while he was working at the University of Arizona. And we ended up adopting him through Pacific Coast Canine, which is the same company that we purchased Brody from. So his purpose here is a little bit different than Brody's. What we've been using Dallas for is our public relations dog. We bring him to the schools. As you can tell, he's totally focused on this ball. We bring him into the schools, and every day we come to work, we're trying to build a culture of trust between us and the community, and we really believe that starts at the school level. And Dallas has just become our icebreaker, where we're more approachable for kids who may be slightly intimidated by us with Dallas around. I can tell you, Dallas has been in the schools for probably about 4 months, excluding the summer months, and pretty much every kid in the state and schools knows who Dallas is and is excited when Dallas walks in the door. We've used them for some of the to help some of the special needs kids focus, and we actually had one incident about 2 weeks ago where I brought him into a special needs class, and the teacher said that that student hadn't said a word all day, hadn't communicated to anybody. And Dallas came in, he started petting Dallas, and he started asking me all kinds of questions about Dallas, and it really helped him to get on track for the day. I was just at the high school for the parent-teacher conference, and I ran into Alyssa and her mom while I was there, and Dallas is growing. They've developed a pretty good relationship, Alyssa and Dallas, and she wanted the opportunity to come speak to you guys and share that experience.
Hi, I'm Alyssa Sangaria. I'm a ninth grader at Stanton High, and once I see Dallas, I am so excited. I have Asperger's. And whenever I feel down, I can trust Dallas, and like he will calm me down, and I'm in love with Dallas. Like I would really want to keep him if I could.
Thank you, Lisa. One thing I did want to touch on is Friday night we had an annual spaghetti feed hosted by the Methodist Church for our canine program, and $1,100 was donated and raised during that event, so a really successful event. And the other thing to touch on to separate the two is Dallas isn't supported through the canine program, so it's still those funds are still reserved for Brody and the narcotics canine. Any questions?
Of course. What's the breed?
He's a Springer Spaniel.
That's a Springer, English Springer Spaniel.
Yeah.
Standard?
AKC, registered.
Okay. All right.
He's 4 years old.
Okay. He's got his eye on that ball.
That's what he lives for.
Okay. Anything else, folks? Come on, dog lovers, get in this. Okay.
So,
here we go.
So you pay for his food and everything yourself?
Wilco Farmers donates his food, and everything else is picked up by me.
Oh, that's awesome.
Okay.
Good job, Charlie.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. Next, Stanley Family Memorial Pool Year-End Update by Billy Marr. Billy?
I don't know if I'm going to be as good as a dog, but and Charlie, of course, we all know him. So I gave you guys a copy of our budget. We've been doing really, really well over there. We did have a loss in September, but we were closed for repairs. The slide looks great. If you haven't been over to see it, the paint on it's doing good. We have a couple spots we're going to have to retouch up, and Mike Brash and I have been talking about that. But besides that, that looks great. I also gave you a copy of the number of people that we have lifeguarded or taught swim lessons to this year. And our numbers are growing constantly. Trying to hire more day people, more night people, and those of you that do go over there, there's a lot of new people right now, so we're working on getting them trained up. We hired our first person through our junior lifeguard program. It's the program that we involve kids and volunteering at the pool to help us with swim lessons and coming in and helping. They don't guard, but they monitor the pool along with helping us with the slide and our rope swing so that the guards can concentrate on the pool. Hired our first one that got old enough since we've started this program, and we had no training with him. He basically stepped in and started lifeguarding. He's amazing, and that's Spencer Hoffman. In 2017, in June, my daughter will be the next one that'll be coming in as one of the first junior lifeguards that have come through our program. So we are very happy with this program. Right now, we have 10 volunteers that are constantly down there volunteering, all under the age of 14. So we are happy with that program. We are also, as you know, partnered with Sanium Hospital in promotions. Sanium Hospital is sending patients left and right to us, which is helping us grow. I actually had a lady yell at me because her doctor sent her down there and she hated the water. She's as happy as you can get. She loves it down there. Also, some of you may or may not know, Friends of the Staten Pool was chosen to be the recipient of Surf Pros Golf Tournament. At that golf tournament, they raised $9,500 that is earmarked for the pool. We have purchased a new top dock, which is a platform that we put in the pool to put small children on for swim lessons, and so they're not holding on to the side of the pool. Sheesh, Alyssa can tell you this, and so can Jennifer. When they're little, that scares them to death. So we've got this for them to be on top of the one that the city had purchased back when Rebecca was here. Last but not least, we have 3 lifeguards that are up for the Red Cross Life Saving Award due to the cardiac arrest that occurred at the pool on June 23rd. The patron that had the cardiac arrest is doing great. He's just waiting for his doctors to release him to come back. We will know by December if those guards receive that life-saving award. And then I'll let Keith know if we do get it. Besides that, we're doing good. I hope, anyway. Do you guys have any questions for me? Okay.
Thank you for coming over tonight. Gee whiz.
Cool. Thank you, guys, and have a great night. I got to go take my daughter home.
Okay. Take care. Thanks, Jean. Thanks, Billy. Okay. Let's see. City of Staten website by Alyssa Angelo. So, are you going to...
Well, I would love to say that we're going to pull it up on the screen, but unfortunately, it's only working for some of us, and right now, it's not working on Dan's computer. I think it was working on Keith's phone earlier, but we just launched it today, and so there's some process to it pointing to the old website and moving to the new one. But it is up and running, and hopefully at the next meeting, we'll be able to actually show it and show it off to everybody. But it was one of the council goals to get a new web design, and as part of improving our transparency and outreach, the new site is so much better. I wish I could show you. It was like, it was up earlier tonight, and we're like, all right, and then it went back to the old site for some reason. It's something with the transfer, but I think you're going to find it a lot easier to navigate and locate information on. It's definitely a lot easier to edit for all of us on the back end of it. And it's definitely updated, and it's not purple.
Okay.
So.
Well, next time then, right?
Yes, the suspense will build until then.
Yes, okay. Okay. Consent agenda tonight is the City Council minutes from October 17th, our last minute. What would you folks like to do with those? They are in your packet for your perusal.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
I'll offer a motion to accept the consent agenda as presented.
Okay.
I'll second that.
Okay, I've got a motion and a second to accept the City Council minutes on the consent agenda as presented. Not a discussion item, so all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Hearing none, we'll declare the motion passed 3-0 and get into the business of this evening, which is a public hearing on residential property maintenance code. And it goes like this. Let's see. The name of the hearing is proposed rate increase for residential property maintenance. That's what it says, but anyway. Good evening. My name is Hank Porter, and I'm the mayor of Staten, and I'll be presiding over this hearing. This is a time and place set for the public hearing in the matter of a proposed residential property maintenance code in the city of Staten. Before opening the public hearing, we're going to receive a staff report, and then we'll have the public hearing. We'll go through the rigmarole with that. So, Dan?
Great. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the council. The issue before the council this evening is the consideration of adoption of a residential rental property maintenance standards within the city's municipal code. The proposed code addresses residential rental property. It does not address non-residential property. This issue was on the agenda for the July 18th meeting, was further discussed by the City Council on August 3rd, and returned to the Council on October 3rd, at which time the Council directed the staff to prepare the ordinance and move forward with this evening's public hearing. Notice of the public hearing was published in the Staten Mail, not last week, but the week before. Aside from provisions within Title 8, Chapter 804 of Municipal Code regarding dangerous, derelict, and abandoned buildings and noxious vegetation, the city code currently does not contain any provisions regarding the maintenance of property, either the exterior appearance or its suitability for habitation. While state law spells out certain minimum conditions for residential rental units, the statute does not provide for municipal enforcement of these standards. Staff has received a number of complaints in recent years regarding the condition of rental units. These complaints have been routinely referred to Marion County Building Inspection or the County Health Department, depending on the nature of the complaint. Under the current city code, the only provisions under which the city may take action are provisions regarding dangerous structures or noxious vegetation, lawns that are not mowed, vegetation that hangs over sidewalks, etc. Lack of water, broken windows, or inoperable heating systems are not covered under the current city code. The city this past summer dealt with one property owner in a case that Marion County Building Inspection did determine the conditions constituted a dangerous building. However, there were other maintenance issues at this property that the city and county could not take enforcement action on, but impacted the habitability and livability of those structures. Over 40% of the housing units in the city are renter-occupied. Adoption of the residential rental property standards would provide a basic level of protection to a substantial portion of the city's population. The proposed standards in the code are based on existing municipal code in the cities of Eugene and Corvallis. They provide for the local enforcement of these habitability standards. The proposed code requires that a tenant issue a written complaint to the landlord prior to any enforcement action by the city, with the exception of conditions that are external conditions and are visible from the street or other property with public access, and requires that the prior to any enforcement action by the city, that the landlord has 10-day period to address the complaint of the tenant. The proposed code establishes minimum standards for structural integrity, plumbing, heating, electrical, weatherproofing, operational smoke and carbon monoxide alarms, building security, and buildings and grounds. Most of these standards mirror or reflect the requirements in the state statute, but in some cases are more specific than a very general or broad state statute. Again, enforcement procedures: the complaint must be from a party to the rental agreement. The complaint must include a copy of the written notice to the landlord, and the landlord must be given 10 days to take corrective action before the city takes any enforcement activity. The City Council has discussed the possibility of financially supporting the enforcement program by a fee on rental housing, as several other cities in Oregon do. The code as proposed does not establish a fee, but authorizes the council to do so through a resolution at some later time. Other cities have established fees ranging from $10 to as much as $55 per unit per year. If Staten had a $5 per unit fee, it would raise approximately $9,000 annually to offset the costs of enforcement. The following the public hearing, the City Council's agenda has for consideration of the ordinance, and your options are either to approve the ordinance and adopt the code as presented, approve it and make modifications, in which case it would be brought back for a second consideration, return the ordinance to staff for further changes, or to take no action and not enact the code. And I'll answer any questions the council has, and then we'll turn it over to the public for their testimony.
Okay, questions for Dan at this point? To the audience, Mr. Fleischman is our Director of Development, and anything else we can stick him with? Nothing? Okay, I'm going to go ahead and open this hearing. Those that want to offer some testimony one way or the other, Dan, one thought before we get started on this, is it reasonable to expect that most of the people that want to say something about this have read through it? Because they'll have things that they like or most likely don't like about particular parts of it.
I would not make an assumption that anybody has read it. It has been posted on the city's website for a month. It has been availed. A draft of the ordinance has been sitting on the counter at City Hall for several weeks. But
okay, well, let's go ahead then, and I'm guessing that we're going to get just a lot of general commentary on the idea of it, but let's see what happens. Proponents' testimony. Go ahead, please. Those in favor of this and their comments, please give your name and address, please, as you start.
My name is Leanne Wiley Troutman, and I live at 1125 Wyatt Avenue here in Staten.
Okay.
And the buildings that we live in have been deemed dangerous and unsuitable for the people to live there. I have a whole packet of information. I have 17 different maintenance requests that I have been requesting help with my apartment since 2013, and nothing has been done. My best ceiling in my bathroom is falling down. My husband has been shocked twice by the box, the electrical box there. The carpeting is so tattered and broken. My husband is half blind and he's fallen into walls catching on the carpet. I mean, there's so many different things wrong with the inside of the apartments, not to mention the outside. There are two balconies that have been threatening to fall off the buildings for the last 3 years, and they're trying to work on it, but they don't have the proper permits, and they have people that aren't licensed or contractors to do the work. The man that owns the business is Monico Gonzalez Jr., and he lives in Torrance, California. He has told us many times, I don't have the money to come up to Oregon and deal with these problems. I don't have the money to do this. But the thing is, we're paying our rent every month to have him tell us that he can't fix our apartment. It makes us wonder, where's the money going if you're not building on the building and fixing the things that's wrong? Why? If we're paying our rent, where is it going? So I am totally, totally in favor of this code because I have electrical issues, plumbing issues, just major maintenance issues. There's so many problems with these buildings. Everybody in the building has something wrong with the apartments, and all the downstairs apartments have problems in their bathrooms. We also have unsafe heating. There's coils in between the upstairs and downstairs apartments. And when I turned on my heater, the person upstairs told me, can you please turn your heaters off? It's burnt my son's foot on the metal between the linoleum and the carpet. So I can't even use my heating because it's burning the people upstairs. Also, there's a sewage leak underneath the apartments that's been there for 3 years. If you walk onto the property, you can smell it. It's terrible. And inside our apartments is so bad that I literally vomit every day in the morning when I wake up because it's so bad we have to close our bathroom up. And it's unsafe for everyone that lives there. So he has come to put lye underneath the buildings like that's going to fix it, but it's not. It's just making it worse. So I don't know what it is that I can do but to explain to you what I'm living in and what the people that I know of are living in those apartments. So I really hope that this passes because if not, I don't know what the people there are going to do. Like, literally, it can cause death. I had a miscarriage, and my cousin lives there also, and his wife had two miscarriages. And we believe it's because of the condition of the apartments, because I had sewage microbials in my system, and that's what the doctor told me. That's why I lost the baby. So I'm dealing with a lot of really bad stuff, and I really hope that you guys can pass this for us. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else from that complex here tonight?
We have talked to a few.
Okay.
They were supposed to be here.
Good. Certainly.
That's my wife. My name is Keith Renard Troutman. And, you know, we've been in an apartment for 4 years, but the owner haven't done nothing for the last 13 years. You know, he haven't. You know, he don't report the rent that's coming in. He's very, you know, kind of racist the way he talks out his mouth and have other people around the apartment talking. You know, especially, and I'm not trying to single myself out, but just because I'm black, you know, he's going to say certain words and stuff and he act like that is acceptable. He has other people there that says it, you know, like last night, the other night. I come out of my apartment and I'm just with my wife, you know. I'm cleaning on my car, excuse me. And they all of a sudden just come out with all kind of bad language and certain things they say out their mouth, you know, which I wouldn't want to say around anyway, but just imagine what I'm saying. And
the reason why is because we're the only ones recording anything on the
Let him talk.
The reason why is, like she said, we are the only ones that's reporting in things on the building, except for another couple and another man that's been there named Gary. What's good? Gary McCullough. All right. Last night, the owner was spreading 42 bags of lime under the building. And under the other building, on this other side, he's got like 55 or 56 bags that he spread the pile under. I have all kind of proof on my phone and everything. I can show you where he has another bag of lye with a plumbing thing sitting on the way. He's planning to go up under the building itself. All this is done because he don't have the money to pay for a reputable plumber or electrician. So he tries to go short and gets certain people he think that can do things. Like last night I turned on my light, I got this here, fire came out of it. And then I was in the bathroom, water is just dripping all out of my ceiling, and it's a hole there with sewage running down my wall, literally. My toilet and my bathtub is sinking in the ground. Not going with the smell, we can't deal with that. You know, I have hospital reports where I had to take my wife from here to Salem to Portland. And they told me to call her mother and her father and let them know that, oh, this is the last time I'll see my wife. And all of them said the same thing. They possibly came from that building where we stayed. You know, we just need some help. That's all, you know. I feel like the building, it really needs shutting down. And I feel like it's taking too long for anybody to shut it down because it's been going over and over. And I feel like he's having some kind of way he's getting away with stuff. That's, you know, and I don't think that's right. I really don't. So,
all right.
That's the final thing I have to say.
Oh.
And I'm sorry.
Okay, thank you. Is that Wyatt Avenue property?
Yes, sir.
Yes, the one that he was speaking about.
Okay, all right, fine. Okay, any other proponents of this ordinance? Okay, let's look at the other side, opponents. And why don't you, Mr. Ellison, why don't you start? I'm guessing. I'm guessing you're on this side of it.
My name is Gregory Ellison, and I live at 20356 Ferry Road, Staten. It's actually out in Mahama, but we're in Staten anyway. And I really don't have anything to answer the complaints that these folks have made. I understand that there are unscrupulous landowners, property owners, who will allow this to go on in their properties. But I know that there are other tenant advocate organizations that can take on these problems. Let me back up to why I'm here. I manage four apartments in Staten and three houses in Mahama for a very nice lady who does everything she possibly can. She lives right there in Mahama, and she's a part of the community. She's been a business owner before she retired. She was a business owner for a long time. Two things. I know that there are protocols in place for tenant advocates to deal with situations like this, and it's going to cause undue hardship on those who run a reputable rental operation. They shouldn't be penalized for some guy that lives out of state that runs a slum that ought to be burnt to the ground. Actually, you know, it's hard for me to stand up here because I've known some people who lived in those Wyatt Street apartments there, and they should be pushed into a pile. There's no question about it. And I helped a lady that lived in one of them when she was moving out, and I found the management to be just reprehensible. They were horrible people, and they treated the tenants horribly. But there are other ways besides enacting a code that involves a lot of people who run reputable rental operations. And so anyway, they will, however, if this ends up being the only way to rectify a situation like this, then the lady that I manage for will most certainly be a part of it and go along with it. So anyway, thank you.
Right. Thank you, Greg. Anyone else? Someone else. There we go. The rest of you folks didn't come down here to just see the circus tonight, so come on. Come on. Get up there, please.
I'm Jim Crother. I'm a property owner in Staten. I live in Sublimity. I don't agree with the ordinance at all. We did not get notified on it. We didn't find out until yesterday that this was even coming up. I don't feel that there's a reason to put a fee on landlords just because they own rental property. Quickly, we drove around town tonight and found at last minute before dark, we found as many owner-occupied houses that were in disrepair as we did rental units. I'm not sure where these apartments are, but if they're that bad, there's other ways to get around it, and there are certain minimum standards. I know with my properties and stuff, when my tenants complain, if it's a fire life safety matter, we take care of it within the next few days. We never let it go more than a week unless it can be rectified temporarily. But you know, there's other ways to go about this rather than to put a fee on landlords. If you're going to do it citywide to everybody that owns property. You know, there's owner-occupied houses that are just as bad. In fact, there's a couple that we drove by the City Hall today, and we noticed that either side of City Hall has got peeling paint. There's one that wouldn't pass. One's a movie theater, and the other one's a rental building that the church does. And I believe the City of Staten owns it, but you guys have written this so that you guys don't qualify. Also, the Moose Lodge, I think you own it too, don't you? It wouldn't pass either, but yet it's not residential, so it's exempt by the way this is written. I think if you're going to do it to everybody, both owner-occupied and non-owner-occupied. Some of the businesses in town could use some cleaning up. They're junk collectors. Most of the rentals in town are maintained, very well maintained. Myself, I have employees that take care of it on a daily basis. They're either working on the rentals or they're working on something else, getting ready to work on rentals. So they're taken care of. Let's see. Yeah, I guess that's all I can think of right off. But basically, I think the majority of landlords that aren't absentee landlords, and the ones that came in tonight are not absentee landlords, will all take care of their problems. I don't let anything go, and I don't think most of them let anything go. They've either got staff to take care of it or they hire people to take care of it. You know, I'm sorry that they're unfortunate to have a California person that is not around, but Maybe it's time to, if that building was empty, they could move to other rentals. That landlord has set up and take notice. I mean, he wouldn't have any income, and maybe that's what he needs. Thank you.
Jim, you noticed that the staff had pulled that idea of a fee.
Yes, but
in the presentation, you heard that, didn't you?
I did, but if you adopt the ordinance, it's just a quick step into the fee. And you know, in fact, Dan said today, there'll be a new council come January, that this one wasn't amiable for it. He said that this ordinance was at the City Hall today. I went to City Hall to get a copy of it. They had no clue of what it was. They sent me across the street to talk to him.
What? Who'd you talk to?
Elizabeth. No clue.
It was there.
She said, I don't know what it is. It's not our thing. Go across the street.
It was there on the counter because I just pulled it off the counter to make copies for tonight. So I'm, unfortunately, I don't know why she didn't know.
This was the first we heard about it, and I heard about it yesterday through a phone call from this gentleman's owner, and she called me to see if I knew anything about it, and I didn't know anything about it. You know, there isn't that many landlords in town. Send us out a notice. It isn't that tough. You send us a water bill every month. Sometimes 2, 3, 4 water bills. Throw it in one of them so that we can see it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Let me add, before the next person gets up, Dan, we wouldn't have notified all the rental property owners about this, would we? Was that part of the...
There was a notice placed in the State and Mail. I believe it was, well, it was 10 days in advance of the hearing, so that would have been not last week's, but the weeks before.
You know, I think if you polled the landlords here, you'd find out that 1, maybe 2 take the State and Mail. Nobody subscribes to it.
Would any of you seen this that went with water bills?
It didn't come to our water bill. It wasn't our water bill. Not at all.
Doesn't come at all?
Nope.
I saw it.
Why is that?
It's in the water bill.
It goes in every water
bill. It's put in every water bill.
It goes in every water bill.
I got 2 this month.
And it's the utility bill that has the water in it, yes. But it goes out in all of them.
What's that? I'm sorry.
It's the utility bill that has the water bill with it, but it goes out in all of those.
Okay. Everyone that gets a utility bill is supposed to get this.
No.
Oh.
Not me either.
Wow. Well, it's possible to have a well or get a bucket in the creek. I mean, I'm okay with that, too.
I think what it is our tenants pay the bill.
Exactly what it is.
And we get late notices if they don't pay the bill.
Oh.
And those don't go in with the late notices. Oh. And that's
so
the way we're going to know
that. If you folks don't live in the community, then you wouldn't have a water bill here either.
No.
Nope. Oh, okay. Okay. All right. Somebody else. Go ahead.
Tom Yeomans. I own some property here in town. I just have one question.
Tom,
what are you going to do for these people?
Tom, excuse me, address, please.
5576 James Way, out off of Bombsville Highway.
Okay, thank you.
So, Mr. Planner, what are you going to do for these people here with this new law? You're going to fix their place? Or condemn it so they move out?
The proposed code allows the city to essentially cite the...
Which does nothing, right? He has no money, he can't fix it. So this doesn't help them at all, does it?
When you're done talking, I'll answer your first question. Let me know when you're done talking. The proposed code allows the city's ordinance enforcement officer to cite a property owner when a determination is made that there's a violation of the code, just like we do when there's any other violation of the code.
So it doesn't
help them?
The
city does. I'll let you know when I'm done talking, and then it'll be your turn. That's the way a conversation works. Just like any other city code, there's not provision for the city. Well, there are actually some provisions in city code for the city to go and actually abate the violation. This code does not have that provision in it. So it would just be a matter of a citation and an order from the court to bring the property into compliance. I'm done. It's your turn now, Mr.
Okay, and this fellow that has no money then to fix his property, what good did you do?
We wouldn't have done any good.
You wouldn't have helped him at all?
We would not have helped the tenant if the landlord does not obey the order of the court to bring the property into compliance, no.
And how long have you been dealing with this guy on that place? On Wyatt Street?
On Wyatt Street? I've been dealing with this property since June.
And is that why this haul has come up from this one property?
That property was the primary stimulus for starting the conversation with the council. There have been a number of other complaints that for which staff has said, we don't have a code, we can't help you.
So can't you refer them to somebody that can help them?
And we have we refer people to Marion County Building Inspection and the Marion County Health Department.
And legal aid?
No.
Why not?
We just haven't thought of referring people to legal aid any more than we would refer them to any other non-governmental agency.
Have you gone to legal aid?
No.
So there are other people. That's all I have to say, that I don't think your rule will help anything. It'll just raise money for somebody to spend.
Okay. Somebody else? Okay.
Judy Mone, 2110 East Pine Street. I just have a couple questions. You don't have a code enforcement officer. It's through Marion County.
Depends on what the code is.
Okay.
Under today's code, there are no provisions regarding general maintenance of a building, mm-hmm. of a rental building, unless they are reach the point that it would be considered a dangerous, derelict, or abandoned structure. In that case, the city code requires that the Marion County Building Inspection make the determination mm-hmm. that a building is dangerous, and then the city's code officer issues the citation or the notice of violation. So there is a part-time employee in the State and Police Department who is responsible for enforcing city code that is not police work type code.
Mm-hmm. And then also for the rental properties, when someone becomes a landlord, are there specific codes on how that building should be at all times, so that if a enforcement officer went in and did a check, they can be penalized for that?
Today there is not. If the City Council enacts the ordinance on which we're having the hearing tonight, mm-hmm. then there would be.
And that's only through if a tenant complains, and if a tenant doesn't, then it just continues on?
Correct. Unless it's, and the only provision that's in the ordinance for enforcement by the city without receiving a complaint is for, let me find it here. Is for standards regarding regarding structural integrity. Weatherproofing. And buildings and grounds, and only in those cases when those violations are readily visible from the street or other publicly accessible property. Otherwise, the code requires that a complaint be in writing, the complaint be from the tenant, and that the landlord has been given at least 10 days to respond to the complaint before the code enforcement officer takes action.
Because I think it's important to have specific codes. I came from a community where there were more than 40% rental. We had really good landlords, and then there are some that are really bad. So there has to be a way, a balance with codes to protect the landlord and the tenants as well. And you're going in the right direction, but and it's unfortunate that you don't have the funds to have a complete housing rental code enforcement officer that can be out there doing it, because there are some tenants that will probably be terrified to even say something if they have a landlord that's that bad, you know. So you're going in the right direction. It's not an easy thing to do. It's just I wish you had more money to be able to look at, like you were saying, housing as well as rental, because housing needs to be addressed as well as rentals too. You're going in the right direction. It's not an easy task. So, okay. Thank you.
You bet. Next lady. And then, Greg, you can say something again. Go ahead.
Hi, my name is Valerie Bell. I have some rentals in Sublimity and a couple here in Staten. And just a couple things I want you guys to consider. And that is, in a sense, if you do attach any kind of a fee with this for the landlord, that will be passed through to the tenants. And I know keeping affordable housing is really, really important. But when you run a business, you look at income and expense. If the expense goes up, you've got to compensate with your income. So we have some tenants that are being abused right now, and I really believe that that's a situation. The state of Oregon has all kinds of landlord-tenant laws that are in violation for you guys. They have advocates, you can call them. So this seems like what you're talking about, rather a redundant system, because you guys do have a place to go with advocates. And I, as a landlord, if somebody gets shocked in my unit, I have a lot on the line, much more than a homeowner. I mean, people can sue me for a lot of money. So that's my motivation, because of the state laws, to keep everything really good, keep everything up to date. So just consider the fact that it's probably going to raise rents and make housing less affordable, which is not what any of us want to do. And the other thing is, it might be a redundant thing that's just causing expense for you guys, expenses here, when there is a system already in place to take care of it, it seems to me. So that's it.
Ms. Bell, could we get an address just for the record here, please?
4300 Northeast 123rd, Vancouver, Washington.
Thank you. Someone else? Go ahead.
I think we didn't follow through with a thought process when this gentleman addressed the issue earlier. When someone is found in violation of the new code, and we went as far as the judge issues an order, and the landlord has to abide by this order, but this landlord doesn't have any money to abide by this order, then I read that on the old website that I read last night. I thought it was pretty cool, but anyway, I'd never seen it before. I thought, wow, this is pretty cool. And I read down through there, then it goes into a lien process. Am I correct in my understanding that if the landlord is unable or unwilling to pay for his citations and to make to rectify the problems, then it goes into a lien situation, and ultimately, if it follows its course, he will no longer be the landowner. Am I correct in assuming that? If it were to go that far.
eventually none of us are the landowners, but the lien would not, the lien would be a lien that is collected upon the sale of property.
Right, but it would continue to compound itself until he would lose control of the property.
I'm not a lawyer, so I don't know exactly how it works, nor am I involved in how the city places liens on property. But my understanding is with a municipal lien, it would not ever be in the position of forcing a transfer of the property. But at such time as that the property is transferred, then the city is repaid the funds that it is owed for whatever reason.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Ellison. Another person standing there.
Hello, I'm Doug Mulvihill, 39778 North Ruby Loop in Scio, Oregon.
Oh, okay.
I have rental properties. I agree with what most people are talking about. I feel bad for you guys. Some of that stuff does happen. The majority of us do not do that. I am a general contractor, and I have been for 26 years. I take pride in my stuff. I keep up with my stuff the best that I can. Unfortunately, there's a handful of tenants out there that are going to say other things, but that's not the case at all. I, by far, and that one gal mentioned, if she had an electrical issue, absolutely, I would be on that ASAP, because I have a lot more at stake than anything else. The other thing I want you guys to remember too is, it's my property and it's my investment. Why would I want my building to wither away? All it does is cost me more money. So unfortunately, you have that small percentage of people that do not take care of it, and I feel for you. There are actions you can do and go after that's already in place. But far as for just starting to add fees to us, I don't think that's the solution by any means, because I think the majority of us do try and keep it up. And once again, if you do, why not attack every homeowner? Because for the most part, I can go through and I can find more homes than I can rentals, partly because we need to keep it up and in decent order, because none of us want to get sued for any reason. And on top of it, it is our investment. I didn't get into it because I was bored and had nothing else to do. It's an investment for me. So absolutely, I'm going to take care of the property to the best of my ability. And unfortunately, my ability being licensed, I do a good job. So I just wanted to be heard.
Just a quick question. For my own information, I heard the part about you being a contractor. You also are a rental property owner in the community.
I am. That's why I became a general contractor. It is all tied in years and years ago why I got into what I do. But I've had
I don't know that property. It's pertinent to this discussion, but what, one unit, 50, 25?
In
Staten.
I have 20 in Staten.
How many?
20.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you.
Thank
Again,
you.
It may not be pertinent. It just thank you, though. Someone else? Anyone else? Okay, we're.
I'm Jeff Crother. Address is 325 Crest Street in Sublimity, Oregon.
Okay.
I've got a question regarding the ordinance, and I have not seen the ordinance. I just heard about it tonight, half an hour before your meeting. I do have rental property here in Staten, but when you start talking about weatherization or weather tight, what exactly does that mean? Who sets the standards and who determines those standards? The inspector, you've got one inspector, is it a judgment call? I guess that questions that maybe you could clarify that for me.
Okay. Dan, can you help with that?
I hope. The proposed code says roof, exterior walls, windows, and doors shall be maintained to prevent water leakage into living areas which may cause damage to the structure or its contents, or which may adversely affect the health of an occupant. That is the proposed standard.
So you're talking watertight then?
No broken windows, no holes in the wall, no holes in the roof, roofs that aren't leaking and dripping water into the unit. That is the standard that is proposed in the code for weatherproofing.
Okay. You're not talking insulation then? You're not going to come in and check the insulation?
I'll read the standard to you again. Roof, exterior walls, windows and doors shall be maintained to prevent water leakage into living areas, which may cause damage to the structure or to its contents, or may adversely affect the health of an occupant. That is the standard that is proposed. Anything that I didn't just read is not proposed.
Is not in it then?
Absolutely correct.
Okay.
There are copies of the proposed ordinance in the back table too.
Okay. Anyone else? Other opponents?
Can I add something? I have a question just to follow up on that.
Name and address again, please.
Doug Mulvihill, 39778 North Ruby Loop, SIO.
Okay, thank you.
On that, who's going to inspect it? Who's certified to do that?
The code makes reference to the city's ordinance enforcement officer.
Which is?
Currently today, his name is Alan Pinto.
Okay, and he has experience on this stuff?
Again, because of the nature of the standards, he probably has the experience to determine whether a roof is leaking, or a window is broken and not been repaired, or whether heating devices are operating, or whether there's a lock on the door. We're not talking about determining that a building is a dangerous building or was built according to building codes. We're talking about the ability to go in and tell whether a place meets basic habitability standards.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You turn on the faucet and either water comes out or water doesn't come out.
Yeah, I guess that's what I was getting at is, I mean, is someone actually certified? Because for me, being licensed, I have to do continuous education all the time, and a lot of it is weatherproofing and windows. You know, it's a big deal nowadays, just like I'm certified and went to schooling for lead abatement too. So there's a lot of protocols that as a builder, as a licensed contractor, that I have to follow, and that's what my question was, is who's coming in and checking this stuff? Are they certified? Do they know what they are looking for? Hypothetically, if they go in there and say, well, it doesn't look like your furnace is working properly, and I call someone that is licensed and certified to take care of it, and they come out and say, there's nothing wrong with it, who's paying that bill?
The standard is for heating that a permanently installed heat source with the ability to provide a room temperature of 68 degrees Fahrenheit, 3 feet above the floor. Mm-hmm. So either you go in with a thermometer or you look at the thermostat and it either says it's 68 degrees or it's not 68 degrees. It's not a matter of, is the furnace working at peak efficiency, was the furnace installed properly? That's all the job of the building inspection department.
Sure. Well, so I had this issue happen to me in Albany at a place I take care of, and I had a bad tenant that decided to go ahead and call and report. Came out here, did the whole inspection, everything. There was nothing wrong with any of it. She just claimed it. The city came in there and they saw that she's using a electric plug-in heater. They just assumed that the furnace did not work. She elected to do that. She also made claims about some wiring. I instantly got a hold of my electrician. He went in there. Absolutely nothing wrong with it. I had quite a bit of expense that had, there was nothing wrong with it. It was, quite frankly, the way she was portraying it. So what happened is she made this claim, false claim. They came in, they looked around. It was filthy because that's the way she lived. So they just were under assumption that all this stuff wasn't working, notified me, I go in there, I get the right protocol and take care of the issues that were no issues to be taken care of. So it actually cost me quite a bit of time and money to deal with this as well. So like I said, just because someone says something, I want to know if someone's qualified to actually go and see about these type of things. Thank you.
Okay, anyone else on this one?
One
more. Mr. C, go ahead. Jim? Excuse me. This is a brother?
Yeah.
Adopted. You guys are brothers?
Adopted.
I'm much better looking.
I would have guessed twins, adopted. But it's all right.
Adopted. He is
Jim,
adopted.
Address, please.
P.O. Box 83, Sublibity.
Okay, thank you.
I just want to reiterate that there are fire life safety laws in effect with the state that covers all of this stuff for heat, water flowing, toilets working, already in place. I don't think the city of state needs to get into that business. And if you've got a part-time person like Mr. Mulvihill said that isn't licensed, you don't want them coming in and telling somebody to fix something when it doesn't need to be fixed for any reason. So I think you ought to think about it. There's other avenues for these people to take, lots of other avenues. And maybe if they don't work out, they need to maybe contact legal aid or a good attorney. It'll get solved. I think that landlord will set up and take notice if he gets a letter a lot quicker than he will from a letter from the he should be taking notice.
Okay.
So
All right. Thank you, Jim. Thank you. Anyone else? Next to last call. Ms. Bell?
Can you come out? Yeah, can you have the microphone?
Yeah, I just wanted to mention that Marion County Housing Authority, they take care of all these things. They have a direct line for tenants, and that's all in place. So again, this seems like a redundant system. So I just wanted to mention that to you guys. Call them, because there's a tenant line, and there's... Keep at it, because they've got legal aid and everything for you.
There's nothing against none of the other landlords, but this one landlord, he is
a bad. We don't want that. So okay. I'm not sure this is going to solve this.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
It's all right. We just keep the dialogue going here if we can. Anyone else on the opposite side? Okay, let's go to any general testimony. We've kind of heard some of that. Anyone else need to say anything on it? Any questions from the public as we work through this? Questions from council?
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Brian.
A couple questions. I think it's fair for the audience to know that this is not the first option for the city to go to. We're in this position, my understanding is because, and correct me if I'm wrong, anybody, that there's no enforcement mechanism in all of the state statutes that you guys refer to. And so we've gone to the state fire marshal, said, yes, this building is not in compliance. We went to the county inspector who said, yes, there's all sorts of problems with this building. The issue is that there's no way to enforce that. And that's how it got to where we're at tonight. Is that correct?
That's correct.
That's correct.
Chief, would you like to say something? Go ahead.
What happened with this one is we received notice that the building was in disarray and these problems were going on. We went and we worked with the Marion County Building Code, and they came out and inspected it as well as the fire marshal, and they addressed the issues that they were able to address. We actually referred several of the tenants to the legal aid. And you can tell from them that they did contact them as well. And we also contacted the Marion County Housing Authority, and we were roadblock. We were dead-ended with what we could do, with what was going on. Those other authorities and agencies dealt with the problems that they were able to deal with, but there was many problems that none of them were able to address, and we were told by them that the only way we'd be able to address them is if we address them in a section of our own code. So we did go those routes.
But you still can't fix the problem. He doesn't have any money to fix it. It doesn't matter what you do. You're not going to fix it.
We have been to court already on several of the issues, and the judge is holding him accountable to the level that he's able to, and it's slow, but he is making a little bit of progress on getting those things taken care of. What he is able to address and what we are able to address with the code as it is today.
Quick, if you're speaking.
You need to respond to that or say something. Get up there and so we can all hear it. Me especially.
My name is Leanne Troutman. I live at 1125 Wyatt Avenue, State in Oregon. My problem with that is that he's got people working on the buildings that aren't contracted. They don't have any type of licensing, and that it's not being built up to code, and this deals with everybody's life that lives there. Like, there's so many things that's wrong with that property that he keeps saying, I don't have any money. We pay $750 a month, and there's 15 apartments that pay $750 a month. That's well over $10,000 a month for the whole entire property. How is it that you can't afford to fix what's going on if you're getting about $10,000 a month out of that property? It doesn't make sense to me that he can sit here and say, I don't have the money. But he's got businesses down in California, construction businesses, trucking businesses, houses. He's got the apartments here, but he keeps saying, I don't have any money. The thing is, he's misappropriating the money that he's collecting. And it's not helping our situation in any way. He's basically taking the money and taking it somewhere else and letting this place fall to shambles. And there's people that live there. I mean, there's 15 families with little babies that are living in a place that has a massive sewage leak under both buildings, not just one. I mean, there's electrical issues. Every outlet in my apartment is burnt. Like, the box was burnt. There was a line of burnt up the wall where it sparked through my wall. I mean, this place is not safe for anybody. And it's the fact that he has money, he just is not reporting it. He's not doing the right things with it. Because I know, because I pay my rent, and I know everybody else there pays their rent or has paid their rent up until bad things happened.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
This is probably on everyone's mind here. Is moving not an option?
We're on disability. Okay. And half the people that live there are either on disability, on housing, or they work four jobs just to keep their little family going.
Okay.
Can I say something?
You need to get up there and tell us who you are. And
my name is Keith Troutman. I live at 1125 Wyatt. Okay. You know, I hear certain things and stuff. See, we know personally what Monica Gonzalez and his wife are doing. You know what I'm saying? Y'all don't see it. Y'all don't be there every day. You know, it gets the people in the community, even in the apartment. He try to play like he don't have any money. He has them paying his trash bill, paying his water bill, and threatening them that he would throw. And most people that's in there are either, how can I say, either on drugs bad or they're refugees. And he threatens the refugees. I heard this personally. I seen the paper where he gave one of them say, well, I would bring the IRS, whatever, the people that pick them up to take them back to Mexico or wherever they're from. You know, it's getting ridiculous. It's really, like I say, I have evidence on all this. All you have to do is to look at these. I don't have no problem with any other person here. I don't want them to pay for what Monica Gonzalez and his wife done. I want him to pay for it. You know, they are good people. They don't have no problem with their property, but anybody can come by 1125. All you got to do is just come by there. The smell is so bad, you're not going to stay there. You know,
Trust me, all the people getting sick and everything. If I had the money to move, don't you think I would move? You know, I'm on disability. I got one eye. The other one is bad. I lost that on an accident at my job. I was a head chef at Marriott. Okay? I lost my sight. My back is bad. You know, I got injuries like crazy. I don't need no extra sickness coming in, killing me. You know, like I said, everybody told me what to do. I did what I thought what they told me to do. I took pictures to the people. Okay, pictures I sent to Alan Pinto. He said I ain't sent them. Right here and said I sent them. I know I sent them. I'm not a liar. I never have been. You know, other building people that come by to check, inspectors that come by to check their building. They say one thing, okay, we send the stuff to them, email. Oh, they try to say like, oh, we haven't received it. Wait a minute, now, I'm not ignorant and I'm not stupid. You know, talk to me like a man. Just because you see me one way at my apartment and I got a hat flipped over, or either I'm washing my car and all that stuff, listen to me. I'm not that kind of person. I'm very educated. Trust me, my parents taught me well and they made sure we got our education. So we wouldn't be played like the people try to play us like we're stupid. And you know, I'm just done with it. And I'm not trying to be angry or nothing. I'm just fed up, you know? And I apologize that y'all, I do not want and only in him, trust me, to go through nothing because of that one sorry person. I want him to pay. Not y'all, him. It's his property that's supposed to pay. I'm done. Thank you.
Okay. What apartment are you folks in?
Number six.
Six. Okay, thank you. Okay.
One more thing.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes.
I believe the public testimony is over at this point, and I still have another question.
Go ahead.
One of the questions that doesn't sit well with me is the inspection and right of entry, and I need to ask the chief what other ordinance in town gives us the ability to walk into a premises like this is proposed.
It would be going into their own apartment, so they would be inviting us into their section of the building, which they could legally do.
You're going into the building to inspect the ordinance beholden to the owner of the property, not necessarily to the tenant.
We would be going into the tenant section of the property.
Is there another ordinance on the books right now that allows us to do that? Give me an example.
Title one of the city code, chapter 124, spells out the provisions and the processes, and I don't have a copy of it here, to gain access to property where the city employee or officer believes there may be a violation of the code. It means going to court and then essentially getting an administrative warrant, if that's the right term.
Okay, so.
But otherwise, this proposed code gives the ordinance enforcement officer the right of entry only upon knocking on the door and being invited in.
So the building's unoccupied. It says if entry is refused, the ordinance enforcement officer shall have recourse to the remedies provided in Title I, Chapter 124 to gain entry. Is that you just referred to the warrant,
correct,
essentially?
Correct.
Okay.
Anything else on that, Brian? Okay. I'm going to take one more question. Jim, you're it if you want to say something. And then we're going to go to a staff summary.
I think really all I want to say is that I think you do have a real problem with a landlord here. And I think you need to go after that landlord. And there's got to be a means to do it. If they're hiring unlicensed people, I know I one time got a siding guy to put up siding for me. He had his son there. The son got a ticket because he wasn't licensed. I don't know who you call, but Doug probably would. There's a contractors board, CCB board.
CCB.
If they're using unlicensed people, there's state laws against it. We can't do that. We can't hire roofers, siders, anything that, if they're not employed by me, we can't do it. So you're still doubling up. You got one bad landlord here that needs to have something done. I agree, no doubt about it. But I'm not sure you should penalize all the others. And if you want to penalize all the landlords, let's penalize everybody across town. I think Hank's house has got problems, and I don't even know where it's at. So let him pay the fee too, and yeah, everybody else. I mean, do it citywide or just go after the one landlord.
All right. I'm going to close it here. Staff summary. Dan, Mr. Fleischman, anything you want to add to this?
I'll try to be brief, and it's not really adding, but it's summarizing. The provisions that are proposed in this code are provisions that currently the city does not have the legal authority to enforce. If we're dealing with issues of habitability and livability, but not a dangerous structure, not building code violations, not electrical code violations, city currently does not have the ability to enforce them. There is no fee proposed in the code. It does authorize the city council in the future to establish a fee should you choose to do so, but there is no fee. Other than that, the standards that are in here are reflective of the requirements of state law today, but do not, the state law is in some cases a bit more general and not as specific as what's in the proposed code. Okay. The proposed code addresses only residential rental property because that's the direction the city council gave the staff in our previous discussions.
Okay. Thank you, Dan. I'm going to go ahead and close the hearing. Council, what would you folks like to do with this? Public hearing and consideration of Ordinance 1000. We are short two people tonight, and that may be a partial reason to defer any action on this for another meeting.
Mr. Mayor, a couple more questions?
Certainly.
Number one, the gentleman brings up a good point about the property owner receiving notification of this meeting. And in the ordinance, what's the mechanism to ensure that the property owner receives the complaint generated by the tenant? Doesn't specify a method of delivery or certified mail or anything.
The proposed code requires that the complaint include a copy of the notice that was sent.
Right, but it doesn't.
There's no way, unless the code was to require that it be, that the original complaint be sent by certified mail with return receipt.
Just no a question, right, just was. A question.
So that would be a possibility.
Second question, Chief. To this point, how many citations has the current property owner in this particular situation at Wyatt received? This point?
I believe it was six.
And that has affected change in what way?
The first ones,
got him to act on the fire marshal notices, and then also got him to address the issues with the electrical. And then the other ones, just recently, he was found guilty in the municipal court and given so many days to fix the rest of it.
Okay, so that would argue that under the current ability for us to cite the individual, he's affecting change. And so that would beg the question of, why is this ordinance needed?
Because the things that we were able to cite him for and address had to do with the balcony and the building code issues.
Okay.
There's still issues of the broken out windows, and I believe there's some other issues that are going on there, falling down sheetrock and things
so
like that.
So the citations at this point have been building code in violation of building code.
Correct.
And fire marshal.
Right.
They
were all after a finding that actually was a dangerous building.
Which neither of those agencies, being the ones that oversee that, had the ability to issue citations for.
The Marion County Building Inspector addressed the derelict building, and which refers it back to us to the citation of it.
Because you had no enforcement mechanism.
In state.
And the same with the fire marshal.
Correct.
Anything else? What do you folks want to do with this? This needs some more work. But if we're all going to live here, there has to be some mechanism to speak for those that have no voice. We've got people fearful of making a complaint about the place they live because they're threatened with eviction or INS, or that's not the community this should be. So even if it's one. Anyway, where do you folks want to be? We can defer this to a meeting with the full council. We can get a couple of more voices on board here.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
We've already been kicking this around for 4 or 5 months now. It sounds like one of the biggest problems that the landlords have is with the fee, and we specifically
no fee
took it out of the ordinance to a resolution last time because we had the same concerns. We don't want there to be a fee necessarily. We don't want it to be passed down to tenants. So. I don't know if it would make a difference to wholly take the possibility of a fee out of there, but some future council could change the ordinance and put one in anyway down the road. That's always a possibility. Well, but our intention is not to.
Or they could take it out.
Yeah
there'd be more public protest over that. So I mean, it would come back one way or the other, but.
The concern here is that these folks have tried all sorts of avenues and have gone to other agencies outside the city, and they say, well, you're the city, you need to do something. This is it. This is what we've got right now. And again, I agree with Councilor Nagel, we don't necessarily need to have a fee. I think the fine needs to be bigger for the person who owns the property. I mean, it seems to me that's the only way to get action, is to scare the bejesus out of somebody to get them to act.
And maintain habitable rentals.
Bingo.
There we go. That's what it's so. Let's move in some direction, folks. What do you want to do?
That being said, I would move to approve ordinance number 1000 as presented.
Okay. First consideration of?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I've got a motion to approve the first consideration of this ordinance. number 1,000.
A second.
And a second. And now for discussion. Anything else tonight? I'll take a statement from the audience.
I know that if anybody that rents one of the apartments that we have in Staten here even breathes of an option to move, I get 15 phone calls from people wanting that apartment. There is such a demand for apartments in this community and rental housing, and there just isn't enough rental housing to meet the need. And that's just the fact of the way things are.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Okay. Council, any discussion? Let's go to a vote.
Mr. Mayor.
Before we do.
Good point there by gentlemen. And I think that's the reason why these folks are in the position they're in, because they're not available to move. Amen. And I think that's why they need more safeguards. And I think that's why what we're doing here is to meet that.
Okay. All right. Let's go to a vote then. Alyssa, would you poll the council, please?
Councilor Lewis?
Aye.
Councilor Quigley?
Yes.
Councilor Neagle?
Yes.
Motion passes 3-0.
3-0. Thank you, folks. And thank all of you for coming tonight and sharing heartfelt feelings. I'm guessing that many of you didn't realize the abyss that these folks had to deal with as far as housing. Okay, probably not, because you're maintaining better stuff. Let's go on to the next, what little there is left of our agenda this evening. Thanks again.
Thank you.
No, there's no unfinished business. There's no new business. There's no staff commission reports. Are there any other presentations from the public? Comments?
The public left.
Right.
Chief's son?
Ryan.
Nothing?
Pressure's on.
How about observations?
We don't want to hear those, actually.
He's forced. His dad has a career in law enforcement planned for him, and so this is the preliminary. The poor kid. I'm going to ask him, what did you see happen here tonight?
I feel like that motion should have passed. I think, but. Well, I don't know exactly, but I think a good decision was made.
Oh, I think it's a fine decision. This is a good council. They do good things. What did you hear? What did you hear around you back there, though?
I heard a number of things.
Don't know if he wants to put on the spot like that, Mr. Mayor.
I'm not going to repeat all of them.
Maybe you can talk after the meeting with him.
Yeah.
What's that?
Maybe you can talk after the meeting with him.
Right.
All right. I have to stay on task here. It's difficult, as you can tell. All right. Business from the city administrator.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. As a someone who spent 5 years overseeing elections, a small part of me wants to remind everybody that tomorrow is, not that everybody doesn't know, but tomorrow is the last day to vote, and we have a drop-off station at the library. So anybody that happens to see this before that deadline, I hope they take the time to vote.
Is that it?
That's it. That's all I have.
That's all you got. Okay. From this end of the room, meeting tomorrow morning with county commissioners, we might talk about housing and county things there. So anyone that other group can come to that, be there. 7:30 at the covered bridge. Business from the council. Anything? Future agenda, public hearing on code amendments and on the 21st, code amendments and possibility of a dog park. And with that, if there's nothing else, we're done. Thank you.